Welcome to our Senior Secondary Environmental Science course of NIOS. Destruction and devastation are ruining the physical and biotic environment of the only planet, that is living planet of our solar system, that is Earth, because of need of the exploding human population. Serious environmental issues are impact of industrialization, urbanization, natural resource depletion, land degradation, air, water and soil pollution. To overcome, we need legislation, that is national or international, and enforcement of legislation. So module 7 deals with environmental management and steps has been taken to improve health of environment for future generations. We have introduced various national and international legislation to promulgate for environmental improvement and conservation. This program is based on environmental legislation, which is lesson 23rd of module 7 of EBS course. The various national and international legislations which have been framed to stop environmental degradation. I am Neelam Gupta, course coordinator of environmental science. Welcome to this program of NIOS. For this discussion, we have with us Dr. Padmija Saxena, assistant professor, Dayal Singh College, University of Delhi. Welcome you, ma'am.
Thank you, Neelam. Learners, today we are going to learn the topic environmental legislation. So environmental legislation means a law which plays a very crucial and important role in regulating the use of natural resources and in protecting the environment. Now, why there is a need for legislation? Legislations are made to protect the environment, or else the need for resources by the growing population will create havoc on the environment. The other important aspect is enforcement of these laws is to safeguard our environment from further degradation and pollution. These must be enforced forcefully and effectively. National legislation. Our constitution originally did not contain any direct provision regarding the protection of natural environment. However, after the United Nations Conference on Human Environment, which was held in Stockholm in 1972, Indian constitution was amended to include protection of the environment as a constitutional mandate. The 42nd Amendment Clause G to Article 51A of the Indian constitution made it a fundamental duty to protect and improve the natural environment. It shall be the duty of every citizen of India to protect and improve the natural environment, including forests, lakes, rivers and wildlife, and have compassion for living creatures. Article 48A states, the state shall endeavor to protect and improve the environment and to safeguard the forest and wildlife of the country. The Department of Environment was established in India in the year 1980 to ensure a healthy environment for the country. This later became the Ministry of Environment and Forests in the year 1985. This ministry has overall responsibility for administering and enforcing environmental legislation and policies. The constitutional provisions are backed by a number of legislation, acts and rules. Most of our environmental legislations are acts of the parliament or the state legislatures. These acts generally delegate powers to regulate agencies to make rules for the purpose of their implementation. The Environment Protection Act of 1986, which is also called as EPA, came into force soon after the Bhopal gas tragedy. Thereafter, a large number of environmental legislations have been passed to deal with specific environmental problems. For example, in the recent past, the use of CNG for the public transport vehicles has been made mandatory in Delhi. This has reduced air pollution in the city. Now, pollution related act, air and water are necessary to fulfill the basic survival needs of all organisms. So, to protect them from degradation, the following acts have been passed. One is the Water Act, second is the Air Act, and the third is the Environment Act. So we will deal with these acts one by one. The Water Prevention and Control of Pollution Act of 1974 and Amendment in 1988. The main objective of this act is to provide prevention and control of water pollution and maintaining or restoring of wholesomeness and purity of water, which includes stream, wells and water on land. Now, some important provisions of this act are: the act implies state pollution control boards and empowers these boards to establish and enforce effluent standards for factories discharging pollutants into the water bodies. A central pollution control board performs the same functions for union territories and formulates policies and coordinates activities of different state boards. The state pollution control boards control sewage and industrial effluents discharge by approving, rejecting or impose conditions while granting consent to discharge. The 1988 amendment strengthened the act's implementation, the pollution provisions. Board may also close a defaulting industrial plant or withdraw its supply of power or water by an administrative order. The penalties are more stringent and a citizen's suit provision supports the enforcement machinery. Second one is the Water Prevention and Control of Pollution, which is CESS Act of the year 1977. The Water CESS Act was passed to generate financial resources to meet expenses of the central and state pollution boards. The Act creates economic incentives for pollution control and requires local authorities and certain designated industries to pay a cess, which is also called as a tax, for water effluent discharge. These revenues are used to implement the Water Act. The central government, after deducting the expenses of collection, pays the central board and the states such sums as it's necessary. To encourage capital investment in pollution control, the Act gives a polluter a 70% rebate of the applicable cess upon installing effluent treatment equipment. The Air Prevention and Control of Pollution Act of 1981 and amendment in the year 1987. The main objective of this act are to improve the quality of air and to prevent, control and abate air pollution in the country. To implement the decisions were taken at the United Nations Conference on the Human Environment held at Stockholm in the year 1972, June. Air Act expanded the authority of the central and state boards established under the Water Act to include air pollution control. States not having water pollution boards were required to set up air pollution boards. Under the Air Act, all industries operating within designated air pollution control areas must obtain a consent or a permit from the state boards. The states are required to prescribe emission standards for industry and automobiles after consulting the central board and noting its ambient air quality standards. The 1987 amendment strengthened the enforcement machinery and introduced stiffer penalties. The 1987 amendment also introduced a citizen's suit provision into the Air Act and extended the act to include noise pollution. Then the third one are the Environment Act, the Environment Protection Act of 1986. The purpose of the act is to implement the decisions of the United Nations Conference on Human Environment of 1972 related to protection and improvement of the human environment and the prevention of hazards to human beings, other living creatures, plants and property. The Act is an umbrella for legislations designed to provide a framework for central government coordination of the activities of various central and state authorities established under previous acts, such as the Water Act and the Air Act. Now, in this Act, emphasis is given to environment, which includes water, air, land, and the interrelationships which exists among water, air, land, human beings and other living creatures, plants, microorganisms and property. The environmental pollution is the presence of pollutant defined as any solid, liquid or gaseous substances present in such a concentration as may be or may tend to be injurious to the environment. The main provisions of this Act are Section 3(1) of the Act. It empowers the center to take all such measures as it deems necessary or expedient for the purpose of protecting and improving the quality of the environment and preventing, controlling and abetting environmental pollution. The central government is authorized to set new national standards for the quality of the environment as well as standards for controlling emissions and effluent discharges, to regulate industrial locations, to prescribe procedures for managing hazardous substances, to establish safeguards preventing accidents, and to collect and dismantle information regarding environmental pollution. The Environmental Protection Act, or we call it as EPA, was the first environmental legislation to give the central government authority to issue direct orders, included orders to close, prohibit or regulate any industry, operation or process, or to stop or regulate the supply of electricity, water or any other services to an industry, operation and process. Another power granted to the central government was to ensure compliance with the Act, which included the power of entry for examination, testing of equipment and other purposes, and power to analyze the sample of air, water, soil or any other substance from any place. The Act explicitly prohibits discharges of environmental pollutants in excess of prescribed regulatory standards. The Act provides provision for penalties. Any person who fails to comply with any of the provisions of the Act or the rules, orders, or directions issued under the Act shall be punished. For each failure or contravention, the punishment was a prison term up to 5 years or fine up to rupees 1 lakh or both. The Act imposed an additional fine of up to rupees 5000 for every day of continuing violation. The Environment Protection Act contains significant innovations for its enforcement not contained in any other pollution control legislation at the time of Act's adoption. Section 19 provides that any person, in addition to authorized government officials, may file a complaint with a court alleging an offense under the Act. Biodiversity related acts. The Wildlife Protection Act of 1972 and Amendment 1982. The Wildlife Protection Act provides for state wildlife advisory boards, regulations for hunting wild animals and birds, establishment of sanctuaries and national parks, regulations for trade in wild animals, animal product and trophies, and judicially imposed penalties for violating the Act. Harming endangered species listed in Schedule 1 of the Act is prohibited throughout India. Hunting species like those requiring special protection, Schedule 2, big game Schedule 3 and small game in Schedule 4 is regulated through licensing. A few species classified as vermin may be hunted without restriction. Wildlife wardens and their staff administer the act. An amendment to the act in 1982 introduced a provision permitting the capture and transportation of wild animals for the scientific management of animal population. India is a signatory to the Convention of International Trade in Endangered Species of Fauna and Flora. Under this convention, export or import of endangered species and their products are governed by the conditions and stipulations laid down therein. Indian government has also started some conservation projects for individual endangered species, like for Hangal in 1970, for Lion 1972, Tiger in the year 1973, Crocodile conservation in 1974, Brown antlered deer 1981, and for elephants in the year 1991-92. The Forest Conservation Act of 1980. First Forest Act was enacted in the year 1927. This is one of the many surviving colonial legislations. It was enacted to consolidate the law related to forest, the transit of forest produce, and the duty levable on timber and other forest produce. Subsequently, the Forest Conservation Act was implemented in the year 1980 to make certain reforms over the preceding Act of 1927. The 1927 Act deals with the four categories of the forest, namely reserved forest, village forest, protected forest, and private forests. A state may declare forest lands or wastelands as reserved forest and may sell the produce from the forests. Any unauthorized felling of trees, quarrying, grazing, and hunting in reserved forest is punishable with a fine or imprisonment or both. Reserved forest assigned to a village community are called village forests. The preservation of protected forests is enforced through rules, licenses, and criminal prosecutions. Forest officers and their staff administer the Forest Act. Alarmed at India's rapid deforestation and resulting environmental degradation, centre government enacted the Forest Conservation Act in the year 1980. Under the provisions of this act, prior approval of the central government is required for diversion of forest lands for non-forest purposes. An advisory committee constituted under the Act advises the centre on these approvals. Biodiversity Act 2000. The Biological Diversity Bill, which was introduced in the Parliament on 15th May 2000, was referred to the Department-related Parliamentary Standing Committee for Science, Technology, Environment and Forests for examination and report. The legislation aims at regulating access to biological resources so as to ensure equitable sharing of benefits arising from their use. After examination of witnesses and recording evidences, the Standing Committee approved the bill with some amendments. The Cabinet approved the proposal for moving the official amendments based upon the amendments of the committee. The Biological Diversity Bill 2002 has been passed by the Lok Sabha on 2nd December 2002 and by the Rajya Sabha on 11th December 2002. Salient features of biodiversity legislation. The main purpose of this legislation is to protect India's rich biodiversity and associated knowledge against their use by foreign individuals and organizations without sharing the benefits arising out of such use and to check biopiracy. The Act provides for setting up of National Biodiversity Authority, also called as NBA, State Biodiversity Boards, SBBs, and Biodiversity Management Committee, also called as BMCs, in local bodies. NBA and SBB are required to consult BMCs in decisions relating to use of biological resources or related knowledge within their jurisdiction, and BMCs are to promote conservation, sustainable use, and documentation of biodiversity. All foreign nationals or organizations require prior approval of NBA for obtaining biological resources and associated knowledge for any use. Indian individual or entities require approval of NBA for transferring of research with respect to any biological resources to foreign nationals or organizations. Collaborative research projects and exchange of knowledge and resources under these projects are exempted, provided they are drawn as per the policy guidelines of the central government and have its approval. The objectives of conservation, sustainable use, and benefits sharing. The monetary benefits, fees, royalties as a result of approvals by NBA to be deposited in National Biodiversity Fund, which will be used for conservation and development of areas from where resources has been assessed in consultation with the local self-government concern. There is a provision for notifying national heritage sites important from standpoint of biodiversity by state governments in consultation with local self-government. This bill seeks to check biopiracy, protect biological diversity and local growers through a three-tier structure of central and state boards and local committees. These will regulate access to plant and animal genetic resources and share the benefits. The proposed National Biodiversity Authority will deal with all cases of access by foreigners. There is no international legislation body with authority to pass legislation similar to national legislations, nor are there international agencies with power to regulate resources at a global scale. As a result, international legislation must depend on the agreement of the parties concerned. So now we will discuss a bit about international legislations. Certain issues of multinational concern are addressed by a collection of policies, agreements, and treaties that are loosely called international environmental legislations. Most of the environmental legislations are international agreements to which nations adhere voluntarily. These agreements are generally finalized through international convention or treaties. To support the conventions, sometimes protocols are to be framed. So, protocol is an international agreement that stands on its own but is linked to an existing convention. Wetland Convention, which is also called as a Ramsar Convention. It is an international convention which came in force in the year 1975. The convention provides the framework for international cooperation for the conservation and wise use of wetland habitats. The convention aims to halt the loss of wetlands and to ensure the conservation of fauna and flora and their ecological processes. Obligation of parties include designating one or more wetlands for inclusion in the list of wetlands of international importance, promoting wise judicious use of wetlands including mangroves. India became contracting party of Ramsar Convention in the year 1981. There are total 26 wetlands under the Ramsar site, which are covering a surface area of about 689,131 hectares. Promoting training in the field of wetland research, managing and wording. Consulting with other parties about implementation of the convention, especially with regard to transfrontier wetland, shared water system, shared species and development of wetland projects. Montreal Protocol. Through this, nations committed themselves to protect the ozone layer and to cooperate with each other in the scientific research to improve understanding of the atmospheric processes and serious consequences of ozone depletion. The convention provides for future protocol and specified procedures for amendment and dispute settlement. The United Nations Environment Program has been addressing the issue since 1977. Under the auspices of UNEP, the nations of the world arrived at the Convention for the Protection of the Ozone Layer in Vienna in 1985. For the protection of ozone layer, the Montreal Protocol on substances that deplete the ozone layer was agreed to by nations in the year 1987 and has since been amended 5 times so far. The protocol aims to reduce and eventually eliminate the emission of man-made ozone depleting substances. The Montreal Protocol uses 3 kinds of provisions. One is entry into force requirement, second is controls on trade with non-parties, and third, research and technology transfer benefits. The protocol promotes technology transfer to developing countries, thereby offering economic incentives for developing countries to join and comply through a network of 507 monitoring stations located all over the country. Under the National Ambient Air Quality Monitoring Program, 290 stations covering over 19 cities and towns are being monitored by CPCB, Central Pollution Control Board. Then climate convention, global warming, which is also called as greenhouse effect, is probably the greatest threat to the future of the planet. It is mainly caused by gases emitted by industrialized countries on the burning of fossil fuel for electricity, heating, and transport. Many nations have prepared national plans and are actively pursuing programs and policies that will result in green gas emission reduction. At the global level, countries around the world have expressed a firm commitment to stop climate change and strengthen international action and broader participation under the auspices of the UN Framework Convention on Climate Change. In pursuance with the objectives of the Convention on the Climate Change and the Kyoto Protocol was agreed upon in December 1997 in the Kyoto, Japan. Now, the other conventions are the Biological Diversity Convention, which was adopted during the United Nations Conference on Environment and Development on 5th June 1992. So, this is all about the environmental legislation, and I hope you all will like to follow these to protect the environment. Thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Padmini Saxena, for sharing information related to environmental legislation. But we would like to add one of the act in detail, that is biodiversity conservation. The Convention on Biological Diversity was adopted during the United Nations on Environment and Development in Rio de Janeiro on 5th June 1992, that is Earth Summit. CBD has been instrumental in highlighting conservation of biodiversity on the international agenda and its implementation on national level. More than 150 states have signed the convention and is entered into force on 29 December 1993. By May 1998, a total of 174 states has ratified the convention, making it one of the most widely adopted environmental treaties of all times. India ratified the convention in 1994. The CBD places emphasis on decision making at the national level. The CBD has 42 articles. One most important concept is carbon tax. Many countries now impose tax on greenhouse gas emission from fossil fuel emissions. Tax motivate industries to improve efficiency and develop carbon dioxide capturing technology. Next is carbon sequestration. Automobiles, power plants, and industries add a lot of carbon dioxide from burning of fossil fuels to mitigate the emission, large-scale tree plantation may be created, improving agriculture practices, also to sequester carbon dioxide from the atmosphere. Dear learners, before we wrap up, we would like to recap the main points, that is what we have learnt. India is one of the few countries of the world that have made specific references in the constitution to the need for environmental protection and improvement. The central government and state governments have utilized this provision to pass various acts in order to protect the environment from destruction. There is a great contribution of UN in addressing global environmental challenges. To implement the agenda of UN, there is movement towards environment protection on a worldwide scale through special conventions, protocols and multilateral agreements. Despite of the presence of satisfaction, legislative measures and administrative setup, it is difficult to enforce the legislation due to lack of expertise, shortage of funds and no seriousness on the part of implementing authority. The main objective of Water Act of 1974 is to provide prevention and control of water pollution and maintaining or restoring of wholesomeness and purity of water. The main objective of Air Act 1981 is to improve the quality of air and to prevent, control and abate air pollution in the country. Through Environment Act, central government gets full power for the purpose of protecting and improving the quality of the environment and preventing, controlling and abating pollution. Most of the international legislation is international agreement to which nations adhere voluntarily. A protocol is an international agreement that stands on its own but is linked to an existing convention. The aim of wetland convention is to halt the loss of wetlands and to ensure the conservation of flora and fauna and their ecological process. The objective of Montreal Protocol aims to reduce and eventually eliminate the emission of man-made ozone depleting substances. Dear learners, this is all about environmental legislation. We will come again to meet you with a new program of environmental science. Thank you.